My name is Mark Hernandez. I am the cheesemonger at the Formaggio Kitchen.
So I'd love to know a little bit about what you do and exactly like what's a cheesemonger? What does that entail?
Yeah, so I get that question so much, believe it or not. I meet anybody at a party and they're like, wait, what? What's a cheesemonger? It's really someone that finds new and exciting cheeses from wherever their focus is, and B, maintains and takes care of the cheese to prolong its life to make sure that it's a direct representation of what the cheesemaker intended. So what that entails is a lot of attention to different productions, farmers, cheesemakers, and understanding what makes their cheese special, whether it be a different technique or just simply this cheese is delicious and stands out from everything else I've seen, and it fits the niche. Right now we have anywhere between 250 and 300 different types of cheese, and so it's a lot.
In addition to just taste and flavor of a cheese, what else do you look for? What else do you consider when purveying a cheese?
So there are different things that go into play whenever I'm considering something for the shop. History is one of them that a lot of people don't really realize, but like the history of the cheese and its sociological impact is so interesting to me. And it might even be that the cheese isn't necessarily always that delicious, but the story behind it and the people behind it and the history behind it is really cool and contextually very relevant to what we're doing in terms of like actually sensory experiences. So aroma, flavor, texture, appearance are all things that I take into consideration, and it's my job to describe to a customer why I have this cheese in front of me. The first thing that comes to mind is it's super delicious. One of my favorite cheeses from the UK called Kirkham's Lancashire. It's one of those cheeses where I could give tastes out all day, and most likely 9 times out of 10, someone's going to be like, I'm looking for something with a little bit more flavor. If I explain it, I'll say, look how subtle the flavors are. Feel the texture in your mouth and what that does to the entire experience. And if I point those things out 9 times out of 10, the person's going to buy a piece because it's more than just the flavor. It's everything that's married together. And it's the appreciation of the subtleness too. I don't want all cheeses to really hit my palate like a ton of bricks.
Yeah. In terms of like the actual taste and training your palate, how do you go about trying to be able to pick up on those notes?
For me, it's just experience. And the more you taste something, the more you're going to be able to pick up on differences and come up with vocabulary to describe those differences. And a lot of it will make more sense. The more you talk with each other, as well, like other people who have different experiences and drawing from them, you know, oh, I get fruitiness. And, oh, I can see that. Like, what type of fruit? Oh, okay, that makes sense. But it is daunting from time to time. I like to tell people, like, there's no wrong answer. Like, sometimes that conversation will get you to open your mind and be like, oh, I thought it was like fruity, but it's really like more, I don't know, grassy or earthy or what have you, but there's a little hint of fruitiness to it. Or I'm just associating fruitiness with sweetness. And so it's conversation with other like-minded people. And then also just the consistency of really tasting as frequently as possible. There's treatments to different types of cheese, for example, that help you with the prolonging of said cheese. So with Comté, they're consistently washing that as it ages to help reintroduce moisture, but also salinity to the cheese. And it just really depends on your end game. Are you looking for something dry? If you're looking for something dry, are you adding more moisture into it, or are you letting it naturally dry out in its environment?
So are you storing most of these in your cellar?
the firmer cheeses I'm storing in the cellar. The younger, more like higher moisture cheeses, I'm keeping in really cold storage. The purpose being is I want to slow down the progression as much as possible. But with the firmer cheeses, they can go out longer. They benefit from the environment of a cave. And so what's really cool about our cave is there's so many cheeses from all around the world, and they're all influencing the flavor of each other in small, small ways. But that microflora that exists in our cave is something unique to us, because we're the only people bringing in these cheeses from Switzerland, Belgium, Spain, France, you know, Italy, that are sort of coexisting in the space and really trading flora. And so it's cool to get a batch of, you know, Gruyere, right? Then we open a wheel right away, we taste it, and we're like, okay. And then we have three more wheels that sit in the cave for a month and a half. And then we open the other wheels, and we're like, oh my God, it's the same batch, but it tastes different. And it either develops in a really cool way, and sometimes it doesn't. It develops in a really, like, not great way. Never to the fault of the cheese, just towards like a preferential thing. Originally, we're at our old shop. We had to move everything over here and start something new. And so when we made that move, there was really a question of like, how do we make sure that this environment will be ready for cheese to sort of like soak up what's in the air? So one thing we did right away is brought the wood over from the old caves into the new caves, because there's a lot of bacterial communities that have been existing there for decades that we want to sort of harvest and make sure it is happy and influencing this cave. One of my colleagues was like, if you're not careful when you put cheese in there, after a while, you're going to start to taste that new construction material in the cheese, because there is flavors that are being emitted from that, aromas that are being emitted from material. And he said, what you're going to want to do is, sounds so wacky, but he was like, you're going to want to harvest some bacteria that's on the outside of like goat cheeses or any rinds, healthy rinds. And he said, just dissolve that in water, maybe a little bit of milk, a little bit of salt, and really make sure it's propagating. And then you're going to want to wash down the walls with that, because that bacteria is going to eat up all of those flavor compounds that might exist there. And so I spent like a day painting the walls with like really stinky rind, essentially.
That's crazy.
Yeah. It was really cool to watch. And like, now we're just dealing with things like different environmental factors. So like seasonal changes in the humidity and dryness of the cave, and what that means for us.